continuation, if you will, still life, though I sometimes feel that that's a very confining word, phrase, still life. So this one is still, in other ways, as Ernan picked up, and he said, is this about dead flowers? And I said, well, a little bit. It does have some dead or bulb things, plant bulbs, which are in there and do create a little bit of a theme, which is my point. That still life, I'll just talk specifically about what I'm trying to use here. I am trying to get the concept of groupings of things which result in still life can be organized for various reasons. And that word organized, sometimes they don't seem like organizations. They may seem like chaos, as though somebody had come in and thrown bulbs and bowls and fruit and whatever, and that's what you got. I just put up four examples, two of them Cézanne, to show different kinds of groupings of different kinds of somewhat similar objects, containers, fruits, etc. And this one, does anyone know who this is?
Ellis?
No.
yeah, I was going to say Ellis.
It's not Ellis. It's a woman named Elizabeth Osborne. Anyone know her? She's a Philadelphia artist. I haven't seen any of her work for years. I don't know.
Actually, Jane Hanselm had some at her gallery.
Oh, did she? Yeah. Well, I used to show there, so yeah. And I probably first heard of her then. But she's an interesting painter, very, very smooth, almost like airbrushing. You know, it's a quite a different thing. And here, I put this up partly just for contrast with the Cézannes. She has disparate objects. Some asparagus, some bowls, some candlesticks. I can't remember what this painting was called. It could have been called Blue Candlesticks, but there's a fireplace behind there. And once, here's my point again, when you start to articulate to yourself what is going on, or what can I say is going on in here, it's a huge step to organizing your own work. So just as you would look at these objects here, and then come to something where, in fact, I submit this all as a whole bunch of questions to you, where I'm saying, does using a verbal description better organize a painting? If one gives a name to the assortment of objects, does that change the way in which one paints them? And if you look at a wall in your house, and this you'll be reminded of some of the things we've done here, like the ones where did the hats and the shadows and the walls and everything. If you look at a wall in your house or here, would it change the way you might use it in a painting if you give it, in your head, something like after gardening, or what else did I say? Or late afternoon, just simply using words like that already bring a concept to it, which can influence the way in which you paint it. So if you called it late afternoon, it's really just those, and that'd be sort of not good. But say it's a painting of those coats with some shadows or something, and then you can see through in the doorway. If you said late afternoon, I mean, it joins these things, the wall, the door looking out, the light changing, it gives a denominator to your painting.
A title.
It can be a silent thing that you just do in the process of pulling all whatever objects together. But it can be, it could be a title. And of course, when there is a title for a painting, people then say, oh, late afternoon, oh yeah. And it leads them where you want them to go. Okay, so there are many ways to combine and edit out the objects in front of you on these two surfaces. And if you only see or say chaos, random things on tables, you might have one thing, and that's perfectly legitimate, actually, or nothing. You could say that Elizabeth Osborne said, random things, this and that, yeah.
With that painting, I think without the fireplace, it would be nothing, but it would be random chaos. But
yep.
With the fireplace, it uh-huh. tells you that it's in a dining room or a living room,
right.
And she's
good.
Preparing for something. I mean, there's a
working
whole
on some
exactly.
And there's a story there.
Exactly.
And it actually, stops it from falling off.
The right. Side. Very good. And that, oh, that gives you a something to fix, you
yes.
know, too, and to fix your interpretation. If this were, if this
yeah,
was
right.
in our room,
maybe, yeah.
then you say, and then you're bringing it into an interior, into an environment. And when you do that, that adds a whole
yeah,
other thing.
Yeah,
excellent. So so if you characterize the scene as what the things we have here as filled bowls, which it is one thing you'll see, they're bowls filled with different things. If that's your denominator, the thing you look for and repeat and render in different ways, and that's your concentration maybe on the bowls, I mean, and how they connect, how the beloved ellipses contrast or repeat, you start finding these connectors. And if you use the words, which I'm going to use in my head, deconstructed still life, which brings in, you know, these things are a little bit deconstructed. They're not a classic, and not that I want to say Cézanne is always classic, but you know, like this, in some ways, maybe it's more conventional with pots and things and the fruit oozing out. It's a big bad feather ooze. This is more deconstructed. Some of the flowers are out of vases or the bulbs or they're on or dying, if you will. And you, if you don't like the dying, make them fresh. That's fine. So you add a theme. Where you might lean toward emphasizing this very chaotic motif is your connector, the chaos, as though it were thrown down, but you know, you pick up, how does it connect? Just the kind of thing you kind of say, what gives you those interesting connections, repeats, there's so many, every factor goes into it, from the color oozing and repeating, to the shapes, to whatever you want. The shadow forms, that's another thing in here, actually, in hers, because it's so clear. She has these shadow forms which just and that would be set here. I mean, this one book, bad reproduction, sorry, but this is it's a Cézanne watercolor, which I think is a fabulously interesting Cézanne and watercolor. And it's almost like a Mirandi. It's almost about spaces and shapes, spaces and shapes. But then you get these things. I always thought that's a watermelon, but this is called pomegranate. He sort of deconstructs this. So really, it's about the colors that repeat and the spaces between what you can't even quite tell are these bottles of shapes, you know, bowls, other fruits. Anyway, so again, do some silent work to bring your things together, and make another silent thing to do. I've mentioned this before, but I haven't didn't remember it for a while. Always include some air drawing when you sit down and you see this and you say, what's going on? And there's too many this and that, and there's too many bulbs. Which, I mean, one of the first things you might do is eliminate all except what you want to concentrate on. But then, just stand there and go, you know, as though you were drawing with your pencil on paper, except it's air, and follow it and go up and go, okay. You're doing something so slight and so silent, you can't make any noise, you can't scratch on the air, can be one of the most important things that you do, because it's your first owning of that.